I think this is the perfect tee up for Shri Sujit Samadar to actually come on stage and address the audience. He's got a short presentation on automobile recycling. So we can have the presentation and then we can open up the questions to the fellow panelists after that and to the fellow dignitaries as well. So Shri Sujit Samadar, please come and join us.
Good afternoon. After a delicious lunch, it's a time for us to think about how we can progress the recycling movement in India. Before anything else, first of all, it's a great pleasure to be here on the 7th MRI International Conference. It's my third one, and each one of them has been better than the previous one. So today, I'm going to talk to you about automotive recycling, which is an important constituent of the overall business of ferrous, source of ferrous scrap. These are some of the many photographs I've taken from my camera. And this is not the full list. I probably have another 30 or 40 more photographs like this of a whole lot of automobiles, buses, trucks lying around the road, which are full of rodents, are a source of disease. And worse, they're an awful eyesight for all of us. So, okay, so this is how I'll talk about very quickly the Indian automotive sector. Look at the policy involvement. And since this is a business community, so you need to look at business opportunity and processes. I'll also talk about new areas that we can work towards recycling and particularly on aircraft recycling. My background is aerospace and defense. So I think there's a lot of work we can do on aircraft recycling in India, which again, the Ministry of Steel will have a prominent role to play in, I guess. We'll look at some business challenges and end with some concluding thoughts. So the Indian automotive sector, as you know, is we are already the world's largest manufacturer of two-wheelers, three-wheelers, and tractors, and possibly the fifth largest automobile manufacturer, if not the fourth. We have 66 automobile manufacturing companies, which employ 32 million people, contribute 7% to GDP. The annual production is of 24 million two-wheeler, three-wheelers, and 4 million cars. And all of them have possibly a life of 10 to 12 years, so you can look at the number of recycled vehicles that will come up. Here again, the rest of the slide talks about the composition of this 22 million vehicles. 80% of it is two-wheelers, and all of this is directly related to the national economy. As we heard just now from our Joint Secretary, the requirement of steel is maybe 300 million metric tons, but the automobile industry will require 50 to 70 million metric tons of quality steel. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, recycling is absolutely necessary for our country. The automotive sector is not static. It's in a continuous process of evolution and development. We have seen the transition from BS4 to BS6 and now to FAME and introduction of electric vehicles. We have seen a rising middle class. We have seen households where not just one car but two cars are now the norm. And we are seeing a young population which is driving the two-wheeler market. And as these products come into the market and to consumers, they will reach end of life and they will also require recycling. Just some numbers. In 2011, we had 140 million registered vehicles. In 2020, we'll go to 230 million plus of registered vehicles. That's a lot of vehicles in India, which we have to find some ways of recycling so that they don't lie around on roads and go to landfills. The policy envelope, I think we heard some very encouraging comments from our Joint Secretary. She spoke about the steel scrap policy, which I think deserves a round of applause from all of us. It's a very fine document and gives us a very clarity on the way the steel scrap recycling business is to grow. So my congratulations to the Ministry of Steel for developing that policy in the short space of time. Apart from that, we also had other policies. Some of them are shown on the chart, and I'll quickly go through. The Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, and that is where MRAI closely worked with them, has also put out some draft guidelines for setting up authorization and operation of authorized vehicle scrapping facilities. As per the statement of the minister a couple of days ago, the policy will probably see the light of day in the next 15 days. Then these are extracts from the vehicle scrapping policy, and I don't want to get into too much details here because shortage of time, but basically the criteria for scrapping of vehicles has been very clearly enunciated, and that makes it very transparent, and it makes it very cooperative for both the buyer and the seller to understand where they are and what needs to be done by both of them. Then, of course, the Ministry of Steel's scrap recycling policy. The policy envisages a framework to facilitate and promote establishment of metal recycling centers. I think this is a very forward-looking and very positive statement by the Ministry of Steel. Then I took down some extracts from it, para 7.4, I think mention was made today, about the role of automobile manufacturers themselves. And I think this is going to be sooner happening than later, when the EPR and PRO regimes will fall into place, just like in the European Union and in many other countries in the world. Vehicle manufacturers and component manufacturers will have to find ways and means of getting back their end-of-life products back into the economic chain. So I think these are very good statements for our country. And as this industry evolves, we'll see much more forward-looking statements coming up and much more facilitation by the government. Then we also had a scheme for scrapping of old commercial vehicles, which was issued by MORTH. It's now 2 years past, but I think there will be some issues that will come up, particularly on mandatorily deregistering of commercial transport vehicles, whether it should be driven by number of years or by certificate of fitness, as the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways has now prepared a whole list of measures for automatic testing and certification of vehicles for fitness. So these are criteria which are under debate, but I'm sure this will get resolved and we'll have a amendment to the Section 59 of the Motor Vehicle Act. Finally, my own earlier institution, Niti Aayog, has of course drafted the National Material Recycling Policy, which is under consideration by the Committee of Secretaries at the moment, as was mentioned this morning. And also, we also have the draft National Resource Efficiency Policy. So these are two, again, documents which have, again, spoke about extending the extended producer responsibility and also for collaboration in automotive recycling. The government of NCT of Delhi also has pulled out a guidelines for setting up of such facilities in India. And of course, it has followed the NGT rules on diesel vehicles and petrol vehicles. So where is the business opportunity? The business opportunity for us lies here. First and foremost, there is so much of interest across the world, and there are a whole lot of young people addressing the United Nations at various forums in the WEF, young people who are now asking us, why are you not being more responsible to Mother Earth? And this is the step, first step of many towards moving towards the circular economy. In the morning, we heard Mr. Amitabh Kant saying that there's probably some movement towards creating a legislation on adoption of the circular economy in India, but it's going to be a key constituent of the whole process. Mention was made by our Joint Secretary on the ferrous scrap requirements at 7 million metric tons per annum, which might grow to 70 million metric tons per annum by 2030 if the infrastructure projects that we have in mind for ports, airports, railways, tunnels, and so many other things, which is $1.5 trillion worth, which is where the government is going to put money in. We are going to need a lot of steel, and we need that steel from us. We don't want it from all over the world. And if we put our shoulders to the task, we will generate that steel in our country, that aluminium in our country, that copper in our country. Automobiles now are the richest source of quality scrap, and it depends upon the detailed dismantling that is done, the processes that are followed, that you can get this out. Informal sector is a very vital player, but it is exploitative of labor, it contributes to pollution, and is not the right thing to do. We have to find ways and means of bringing them back into the formal sector in some way. So we have the acts, we have the laws, we have the rules, and we are sitting on an ideal opportunity to pioneer formal recycling of vehicles to tap the emerging mega market that emerges here. So these are some numbers here. The US scraps about 12 to 15 million vehicles a year. India is at 3 to 4 million. And I think this number is a guess. I would think the number may be quite larger. And we have an average age of 15 years. And if you move towards 11 to 12 years in the next 5 to 10 years, that number 3 to 4 million will easily double. And we'll probably end up being the second largest number of scrap vehicles in the world in a few years from now. So that's a business of about $7.5 billion. So when you drill down into it, these are some data that we have got on the total number of ELVs and how do they contribute. You're looking at almost 22 million vehicles, and the composition that you get from each of these sources are shown on the slide. So there's a lot of useful material which is lying on the road, and that needs to be brought back into the economy. So in the In the automotive recycling space, the basic segregation is finding out what needs to be done at the collection center level, what needs to be done at the dismantling unit, and what needs to be done at the creation of mega recycling facilities. But other things which are not scoped is the final production of the recycled materials into end-use products, and that might take us a little time before we can build up those mega parks which look at the entire value chain from the beginning to the end. So that's some way down the line, but I'm sure we'll get there sooner or later. The key challenge for most material recyclers in automotive industry today is land. The minimum land that is required to do, I've just come back from a visit to Japan and I've seen the kind of recycling facilities that they've got. They're spread over 50 acres and they're amazing facilities where they're generating so much of quality scrap, which goes straight from, not into foundries, they go into furnaces, but directly to foundries, where you can actually convert that metal back into another gearbox casing or engine block or whatever. So that's the kind of detailing that has that is happening, and we should aspire to meet and better those standards as we move along. The business model has been spoken about, but by and large, it's a mix of collection hubs, dismantling units, and metal recycling. The calculations that we have done in my work so far is that you need connected dismantling units because the logistics cost is tremendous in India. They're tremendous, and they can contribute to a sizable percentage of the overall processing cost for automobile recycling in India. So you need to have hubs, collection centers, and dismantling units, which are geographically optimized. The number is 500 kilometers, but my sense is between 100 kilometers plus, the logistics costs far, far exceed the rental and the processing costs. So this is a challenge for us, and to find that land from the government sources or from private players is, believe me, a big, big challenge. So that brings me to my second subject of aero recycling. Which again is a very forward-looking business opportunity for India. As you know, we're getting 100 new airports coming up. We already have 485 airports in this country. We have very good quality manpower to do dismantling of aircraft, and it's an opportunity that is just waiting to be developed. And again, aircraft have the highest quality of material. And if we can bring that scrap back into the economy, it'll be very nice. Next time when you take a flight from Delhi, you will be saddened to see the number of aircrafts which are just lying in the airport waiting to be dismantled or to be taken by somebody for processing. And I'm not just talking about commercial aircraft here. As you know, the Indian Air Force and the Army and the Navy and the Coast Guard and the BSF and various other government agencies all operate aircraft, and all of them are getting old. Just to give you an example, there are almost about 300 fighter aircrafts which will be reach end of life soon. That's a lot of money. We'll have at least 75 transport aircrafts which will reach end of life in the military sector, and more than 200 helicopters which will be lying around junk somewhere to be converted into useful material. And of course, in the private sector, we have 685 aircraft run by 13 airlines, which again is a good business for us. So this is a quick slide as to how you buy, then you lease, the sell, the convert, the MRO, do the upgrade, then you have to dismantle and put it back into the supply chain. This is a detailed story. Those of you who want to know more about aircraft recycling can meet up with me a little later, and we can talk about how we can extract valuable material out of aircraft recycling. That opportunity exists in India, and the sooner we realize and exploit that opportunity, the better for us. There are a whole lot of controls on aircraft recycling, just as there are controls on automobile recycling, and some of these are shown on the slide. And there are infra and tech issues. Basically, runways is the key challenge. You must have aprons and hards, and you must have warehousing support, and you must have trained manpower with MRO background. All of that exists in India. So from an operations perspective, what challenges do we see in the recycling of automobile businesses? First is the feedstock procurement. I think the Vahan database, which is actually the National Register for Automobiles, is the key document that has to be accessed and evaluated to find out where the cars are, apart from them being on the road just like that, or you do curbside or on-site. Then you need to find out the scrap sales business. There's also a lot of IT which has to go into all this. We saw a slide in the morning today about using AI for plastics recycling. You know, there are lots of things that can be done to make this very, very smart and good. And all of that will get rid of the ills of the informal sector. Depollution is another very important point, and how we bring in technology to make sure that we use vacuum pumps for fuel, fluids, and gases. not just gravity fed. We also figure out ways and means of taking the hazardous metals out of it, the rare earths out of it, the hazardous non-metals out of it, particularly asbestos and stuff like that. De-risk from batteries and switches and seat belts and airbags. And there are plenty of process options. I have now seen the European Union, how they do it. I've seen how the US does it. I've seen how the Chinese do it, how the Japanese do it. But ultimately, we'll have to find our own Indian way of doing it. And the solution probably lies in more being labor intensive, doing more detailed dismantling, rather than using these huge nibblers and crushers, which you know, just leave a lot of ASR, that is automobile shredder residues, which are more harmful, believe me, than just the scrap that we can generate. There's a lot of technologies here, machinery, labor, sorting, shredders, nibblers, separators, all of that is doable, and the time is just ripe for people to get into this business to be able to generate the steel that the Ministry of Steel wants us to generate for them. Technologies here, I told you, there's also certification and documentation issues, training and safety systems, logistics, and finally, citizen awareness, information education, which is, I think, going to be one of the primary responsibilities of this organization to communicate to the people of our country that, look, you're sitting on wealth, don't waste it. In conclusion, we heard this in the morning, India's material requirements are growing exponentially. Continuous using virgin materials is infinitely not sustainable. I've learned that Germany is going to stop all mining from 2030. That's a huge statement. And I think I think we have taxed Mother Earth enough, and we should stop taxing her more. And all the other factors about recycling are well known to this audience, so I don't need to dwell on it. But at the end, I must say that today India has every capability and resources and policies and the government's full support to be the biggest player in automobile and aircraft recycling industry. With these words, I commend this this presentation to you. I'll be happy to take some cars. And finally, all of you, one day will have an end-of-life vehicle. Please donate it. Please donate it. Transform the life of 10 girl childs forever. Donate once, 10 girl childs will improve their life forever. That's my appeal. And with that, I close my presentation. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to take them later. Thank you very much.